1966, Haitians, Cubans, and American soldiers of fortune conspire to invade Haiti from a little beach called Coco Plumb outside of Marathon Key in Florida. The goal was to topple Papa Doc Duvalier, then gather Haitian support to launch an invasion of Cuba and eliminate Fidel Castro.
Are those people armed with the latest weapons, weapons like these, put in their hands? Where they practice the use of these weapons not far from Miami, Florida? Are men like these, with this kind of training, later to be carried out of the United States in American ships, are these men and these weapons to turn Cuba into a battleground again?
These events in the turbulent 60s found Eloy J. Esagedo Lliraldi in exile, conspiracy, the CIA, FBI, soldiers of fortune, and CBS Broadcasting filming a documentary of a Caribbean revolution as it happened.
To back up the hopes of those counter-revolutionary groups, tools like these are being collected, second-hand weapons of all kinds.
This is the story of 1966 Project NASSAU, Operation Istanbul. Eloy J. Esagedo Lliraldi arrived in Miami, Florida on September 23rd of 1962. Born in Cuba, he, along with other friends, would sabotage Castro-controlled communications in Cuba, toppling telephone poles and electrical lines along with other acts of disobedience on the island. Word got around about these anti-revolutionary acts and danger of arrest loomed for him and his friends, so Eloy was sent away by his family to avoid imprisonment or elimination, as many anti-Castro opposers had been condemned to firing squad or incarceration. For the first few months in Miami, Eloy slept on the couch of relatives that had moved to Florida years before. Not long after, on October of 1962, he reported for service with the armed forces at 4100 Aurora Street, Coral Gables. In 1963, Eloy graduated. The soldiers were all Cuban exiles and were trained by the Army for use with CIA operations to topple Castro. The brigades were afterwards stationed in various locations around Central America. Eloy was based in Guatemala. However, military operations were discontinued sometime during the Kennedy assassination of 1963. The Central American base Eloy was stationed at was shut down, and he, along with other soldiers, were the last of the troops waiting to be picked up and shipped back to the U.S. Back in Miami a few years after, and in 1966, a plot was hatched by Cuban exiles along with soldiers of fortune, the CIA, and Haitian exiles. Rolando Masferrer was a senator in the Batista government, pre-Castro era. After Fidel Castro took over Cuba on January 9, 1959, Masferrer had to abandon the island because Castro accused him of stealing $10 million.
He's the enemy. And in dealing with such enemies, the way you are about to see, what you are about to see, is the stuff that vacuums which follow revolutions are made of. He's been given the choice of giving the command for his own execution.
In the United States, he befriended mafia bosses such as Santo Traficante, as well as union leader Jimmy Hoffa. Masferrer established the 30th of November organization with the purpose of killing Castro. Masferrer, also known for mistreating Cubans residing in Florida, extorting money from them for what he said was to help Cuba. On September 26, 1960, Masferrer sent an expedition of four boats to Cuba. One boat reached Cuba. Three Americans, Alan D. Thompson, Anthony Zarba, and Robert O. Fuller, were caught and eventually executed by the Castro government. In December 1960, the Miami Herald reported that Masferrer was leading a small group of 53 people who were polishing their killing skills at a ranch owned by multimillionaire Howard Hughes. In 1961, Masferrer met with President John F. Kennedy, presumably to talk about Castro and the situation in Cuba. But Kennedy disliked Masferrer's radical and fanatical personality, and the two never established any publicly known conversation after that. In 1966, Masferrer and other Cuban exiles plotted to accumulate weapons and boats to invade Haiti so as to have a base free of U.S. law to attack the Castro government of Cuba, which had foiled his direct attempts to land in the past. Eloy J. Esagedo Lliraldi would be among the invaders of this new plot. Project NASSAU was the designation given by Mitch Worbell and CBS News for the invasion of Haiti by Haitians, Cubans, and American soldiers of fortune. Planning began in the spring of 1966 when CBS became aware. The actual designation was Operation ISTANBUL. They decided to take the opportunity to film an actual Caribbean revolution. The producer and film crew were dispatched to Miami with Mitch Worbell as an advisor. Freelance journalists also filtered in like Andrew St. George and Tom Duncan. Filming for the CBS production was from a rented boat called the Poor Richard by a man known as William Harvey. Rifles were rented by CBS and filming took place in a South Miami park. Most of the CBS production crew were informants for one government agency or another, so the entire invasion was stopped in early January 1967. With the arrest of 75 would-be invaders, Congress held hearings on the matter to determine if CBS was financing revolutions. List of Haiti invaders. U.S. Customs Intelligence Bulletin, January 20, 1967. Last month's bulletin recorded the fizzle of an attempt to invade Haiti from southern Florida. This provided to be only the end of the first episode. For on December 28th, custom agents learned of plans involving a deserted house on Coco Plumb Beach, 7 miles north of Marathon in the Florida Keys. Setting up a surveillance was not easy, since the site was a fill island with only one house on it, plus ample docking facilities. However, the officers were equal to the job. During the early morning hours of December 29th, CPIs saw figures making their way to the house under cover of darkness. The following day, vehicles began to arrive and continued to do so for the next 5 days. Most of the activity occurred during the night and early morning hours. Large van-type trucks were seen to arrive and unload at night. On one occasion, a CPI saw through his binoculars a rifle being unloaded. During the daylight hours of December 31st, a CPI saw through binoculars a man carrying under his arm what appeared to be an automatic weapon as he moved from the lower to the upper floor and back down again. It was learned that 4 vessels, the Columbus and the Francisco, left Miami but broke down before reaching the open sea. The vessels returned to Miami and were apparently abandoned because of the need of 4 repairs. Custom agents and CPIs searched the Columbus, found 10 pounds of C4 explosive, and effected seizure of the craft without conspirators knowing what had happened. During the early morning hours of January 1st, the 55-foot MV Sandona left Miami but also broke down, and during the next night ran aground about 2 miles from its destination. At high tide, about noon on January 2nd, it was refloated and taken to Coco Plumb Beach, where the group immediately undertook needed repairs. Activity increased during the afternoon and early evening, and about 8 p.m. the officers learned the vessel was being loaded with arms in preparation for departure. Custom agents and CPIs from Miami and Key West surrounded the premises, found the vessel was indeed loaded with automatic weapons, and discovered in the house nearly 80 Cubans, Haitians, and Americans, all dressed in army camouflage fatigues, and many carrying sidearms, rifle mortars, and grease guns, a type of submachine gun, were in evidence throughout the house. The men and one woman in the party were brought out of the house to separate them from the weapons. After much discussion and many tense moments, some semblance of order was established without any shots being fired, and efforts were made to identify each individual by name and place of birth. Calls for help were sent to the sheriff's office and the highway patrol, both of which responded. During this process of identification, the group became impatient and demanded that they either be placed under arrest or allowed to leave. Indeed, the leader mustered his troops and started to march away to Key West, some 55 miles distant. Since this could obviously not be permitted, it was decided in conference with headquarters to arrest them all. As the jail at Key West could not hold the whole party, only 23 of the leaders were sent there, and the other 50 men to Miami. seized at Cocoa Coco Plum Beach were the MV Sandoval, two cars, an old truck, and the following arms. On January 5th, the conspirators in Key West were taken before the U.S. Commissioner, five at a time, and were released on personal recognizance of $2,500 to $5,000 each. Mas Ferrer, however, was immediately rearrested by immigration officers and taken to Miami as a parole violator, having been ordered by a court in 1959 to remain in New York. His companions kicked the immigration car and tried to follow it, but were held back by local officers. On January 12th, he was released again under $10,000 bail, with additional restrictions on travel. Recounting the events of the 60s, Eloy J. Esagedo Lliraldi explained that before the court, all of them were released, with the agreement that they would return if so summoned. However, that never happened. According to him, CIA and FBI had stepped on each other's shoes, so these events were swept under the carpet of history. This story is not a complete telling of the events of 1966. There is much more to say about the people involved, but this has been a good overview. For more, check out the links in the description for further study and research.